Well, clearance has been given for Australia's first ever commercial space launch. Gilmour Space Technologies is expected to make its first test flight within a few weeks and already has Australian customers signed up waiting to get satellites into orbit. Bloomberg's Paul Allen has more.
History will soon be made in this field in North Queensland. Gilmour Space's 25-metre-tall, 30-tonne rocket is cleared for launch by Australia's space agency.
It's really, really hard to come up with an orbital rocket, and I'm happy that we've gotten to the point we have, and I really hope that the first launch goes reasonably well. Not expected to go to orbit, historically they never have, but we're going to learn a lot.
It's been a long time coming. Gilmour Space started its rocket program in 2015 and was initially expected to launch in 2023. Getting regulatory clearance has taken longer than expected.
You can imagine when you go to a regulator and say, hey, guess what? I want to launch an orbital rocket from Australia, the kind of first reaction. So we've spent a lot of time educating a lot of different people.
Customers are already lining up. First in the launch queue is Space Machines, an Australian satellite company that offers roadside assistance in space. Once in orbit, its mini modules wait, deploying when needed to carry out repairs to other satellites. For Space Machines, having a local launch option will be a game changer.
I think it gets rid of a lot of different costs. Having a launch capability in Australia will mean we won't have to travel much, we don't have to think about spacecraft getting damaged, having capability to very quickly turn it around for subsequent launches. So I think it gives you a number of advantages of having it onshore.
The significance of pushing through all the technological and regulatory barriers to get the rocket to the launch pad also can't be understated.
Adam's done an amazing job of, persevering through all of that. You know, there's a sort of almost a colloquial thing where US produces unicorns, I think Australians produce cockroaches. We need to survive. And in the process of survival is success.
In terms of survival, while the test launch for Gilmour Space is an important milestone, harder challenges are yet to come. A regular, reliable launch schedule and ultimately turning a profit.
In the last couple of years, we've just had continual customer demands for us to launch. And so, the customer equation's there and it's there as strong as it's ever been. So I think they understand once we get the technology right, our path to profitability is very quick.
As for liftoff, an exact date hasn't been settled, but space geeks keen to watch the show might consider a Queensland beach holiday for early 2025. Paul Allen, Bloomberg, Sydney.
And Paul is here with me as we talk a little bit more about the outlook for Australia's space sector. Let's bring in Cassandra Steer, who's a chair at the Australian Centre for Space Governance. Cassandra, great to have you with us. And obviously very exciting to be able to get finally this approval. How meaningful is this, do you think, when it comes to the broader space industry and the ability for more commercialisation or perhaps quicker progress?
Yeah, well, first of all, thanks for having me. And it is exciting. We do have two existing spaceports, but they operate kind of like an airport. They're there for others to bring their rockets. We've had NASA launch very small sounding rockets from the Northern Territory by Equatorial Launch Australia. And there's another site in South Australia that's run by Southern Launch. But the fact that Gilmour has its own rocket, because I think perhaps it's not clear to a lot of people that the rocket is one thing, it's the launch vehicle, but there are other companies like Space Machines that are building satellites that just need to get them into space. So having an Australian rocket that's able to launch from Australian soil is quite exciting. But I think we also need to temper what this means in terms of this is not going to open floodgates of launch capabilities. I mean, there was a story earlier about the size of SpaceX, the biggest company in the US. It's the biggest commercial launch provider in the world. And Americans and a lot of other clients around the world go with a proven reusable rocket that's a lot cheaper. We certainly will see opportunities for Australian-made and locally-made and regionally-made satellites being launched from here, but we have to temper expectations about how big that market is.
Where do you then find the more niche opportunities then? Because as you point out, there's not a real competitor to SpaceX yet. There is also in our part of the world, Rocket Labs, just over in New Zealand as well. So for Australia, what's the path forward to be able to not have more commercialization, but perhaps more opportunities that are not yet as well tapped?
I think the biggest opportunity for Australia is the launch and return end of things. So in the next couple of decades, we're going to see point-to-point suborbital travel become possible. So they still need to be rockets. They don't need to get to orbit. They go into space and they come back down. And that means we could get cargo and maybe aid packets and eventually people from Australia to Europe or North America or the Pacific in a matter of a couple of hours. So I think that's going to be the groundbreaking thing in the future. And we really need to look out for the opportunities for return and relaunch in Australia. But the other thing is that space is overwhelmingly commercialized. You and I have used space at least 20 times today already by checking the weather, using navigation, if you get an Uber somewhere or order food or order delivery of items online, when you buy a coffee with your phone. We're using space services every single day. And there's about 10,000 operational satellites today. 75% of those are commercially owned. So militaries are buying commercial space services, governments are buying them, and you and I are using them. So that market is not going to go away, and there are definitely opportunities in that sense.
When I was speaking to both Adam Gilmour and Space Machines for that story that we just saw, they were both very diplomatic about the role of regulators, but you could sense the frustration and the slowness in getting this done. As the industry matures, do you see the regulatory process getting a little bit easier? And to what point is it a hindrance at the moment?
Launch is a very specific technology. So there's different permits required. If you are a satellite operator like Space Machines, you need to go through a different set of permits and regulations than if you are operating a spaceport like Southern Space and ELA are. And then a different set again if you want to launch your own rocket from a space site. So I can understand that for Gilmour it's been frustrating. They've had to reassure investors and it's taken a while. But the Australian government absolutely did the right thing by taking its time. This is the first time the space agency is given this particular launch permit. We need to think about things can go wrong. You know, as Adam Gilmour himself said, it's a test the first time. There's issues around rocket fuel. Everything that goes up must come down. There will be small amounts of rocket body, possibly bits of debris. There's bits of propellant that might remain in the atmosphere. Gilmour Space is quite close to the Great Barrier Reef. We need to think about environmental impact. We need to think about the impact of the noise of the launch on local wildlife. So they needed to go through a series of very important regulatory checks, insurance checks, those kinds of things. So they absolutely did the right thing by taking their time. And other kinds of permits are much faster, particularly for satellite operators, because we have more of those in Australia than we do a rocket launch company.
Yeah, the Gilmour rocket at the moment is not reusable, well, yet. In the 21st century, can a rocket launch company be competitive with an expendable rocket?
That's the question. I mean, SpaceX has really changed the game by creating reusable rockets. That has environmental benefits, obviously, because every other rocket in the world to date is single use. That's the equivalent of building an airplane, using it once, and then throwing it away. So making them reusable, SpaceX has done a really incredible thing technologically. It's also reduced the price of being able to hitch a ride on that as a satellite operator and get your satellite into space. So it is hard to be competitive with that. At the same time, if you have to get your satellite, which you've built in Australia or you've built with components in the region here, and you have to ship it to the US, there are enormous shipping costs, insurance costs, and risks that your very delicate piece of hardware might get damaged along the way. So there are different avenues that could be competitive for different reasons. I don't think Gilmour's rocket design is set up to be reusable in the foreseeable future. I think that's where all rockets eventually will have to go. But this is all, you know, it took quite a while for the aviation industry to become what it is today. It's going to take a while for these launch vehicles and suborbital vehicles to become reusable.
Cassandra Steer, who's from the Australian Centre for Space Governance. She's the chair there. Really great to have you with us. We have more on Australia Ahead every Tuesday at 11:40 a.m. if you're watching in Sydney. That's 8:40 a.m. if you're joining us in Hong Kong. Plus, you can tune into the Bloomberg Australia podcast, delving into the biggest stories shaping the country's role in global business. You can find that on Apple, Spotify, or Bloomberg.com.